Let's come together. We want to learn tonight about desire, desire, desire. When we talk about desire, desire, am I calling it right? What do we understand by the word desire? Desire is something to die for. Something to die for. Last week Sunday, or two Sundays ago, I was giving an example with Brother Gene. He texted me that he's not going to be able to make it today because he's caught up with a couple of things. And I was appreciating the fact that he drives all the way from Huntsville. If you know where Huntsville is, Huntsville is quite far from here. Chizaram and her mother, Grace, they drive all the way from Pearland. That's far. They drive all the way from Beaumont. And then Magdalena, Montgomery. These are distance where people drive to come to church. Even 1960, thereabout. Yeah. Yeah. Now, this is where I'm going. If it's not something to die for, then it's not worth it. If it is not something to die for, it's not. If it's not something beneficial, it's not worth it. Because when you drive 50 miles or more to get to wherever you want to go, it must be desiring something good. I found a restaurant somewhere at 1960 with my wife, because, you know, we like seafood. And I live all the way in Richmond. From my house to that place, that's far. I had to tell the people that you guys need to treat me good, because I come from far. Even though I know your food is good, because I desire it, I don't look at the distance. I don't look at how far it is. I don't look out whether I'm tired or whether I have gas in the car. I just plan, no matter what, I just want to go there and eat me some pork fish, eat me some shrimp. Desire. I want you to write this down. Desire creates pursuit. Desire creates pursuit. Whatever you desire, you pursue. Whatever you desire, you pursue. There is never a pursuit without desire. If you want to succeed in anything, in any area of your life, you must have desire. If you want to succeed in any area of your life, whether academically, or business, or ministry, family, you must first have desire. Desire creates pursuit. You desire to succeed in relationship, so you do everything to build that relationship. If you desire to have your business going well, you do everything. If you want to grow, your desire will put you in a place of restlessness. If you want to grow in anything, your desire for that thing will put you in a place of what? Restlessness. Have the desire and pursue it. Because without desire, you cannot pursue it. Do you desire to see your business grow? Do you desire to see whatever you are doing in your school or your academic, whatever it is? I've come to realize that in life, it's not about distance, but about desire. Just like we just talked about Montgomery and Huntsville, you know, I told Mama the other day, I said, even if you put church in some people's bedroom, if there is no desire, they will look for excuse to say, you know what, Pastor, can I sleep for another 2-3 minutes in their bedroom? I know of some people that at church is like 5 minutes or 10 minutes away from them, or 15 minutes thereabout. But the complaint I received when we moved out here, I said, my goodness. The first thing I asked, I said, where do you work? How far do you work? Oh, I work downtown. I said, but you don't complain going to downtown. You don't complain. Some of them work in Conroe. They don't complain going over there. But because you don't have the desire to fellowship, you don't have the desire maybe to learn or to grow spiritually. You don't. There's no desiring something. So you look for excuses. You see, I wrote something the other day on my Facebook, and I said, if you want to do something, you'll find a way. But if you don't want to do it, you'll find excuse. Because there's no desire. I'm saying that again. If you want to do something, you'll find a way. But if you don't want to do it, you find excuse. Because there's no desire. There's a good excuse. And there's a bad one. Because when there is no good desire, you will look for all kind of excuse. Whatever you don't desire, you treat casually. I want to write that down. Whatever you don't desire, you will treat it casually. We're talking about desire. Whatever you don't desire, you don't make extra sacrifice for it. Because desire creates pursuit. Are you with me? We desire all things that our flesh want. And this is where I'm going with this today. But how much do we really desire to know God or the things of the Spirit? I'm going to break this down. We desire food. We desire to have good things. We desire so many things, which there's nothing wrong with that. We have desire for everything that we just want to desire, that our flesh want. But how much do we really desire the things of the Spirit? How much do we desire the things of God? Man is full of desire, but less desire for the things of the Spirit. I'm telling you, if you ever seen people who are in love or just fall in love with, I remember when I met my wife and we started dating, and she traveled to Europe, and I was back at home. Man, we will talk for hours. Sometimes I'll be on the phone, we're saying nothing. I just love you. I just love you. I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you. There's no word to say anymore. Then, because of the time differences in from Nigeria and back in Europe, when it's morning, it's night in Africa. It's evening. And I know the time that she will normally call me. And then there was no cell phones. We didn't have cell phones at that time. We had the, you know, the dial. So Mama will call me, and in my house, we didn't have any phone. But I had a friend who lived far that I used to go receive a call. Now, how I do receive that call is that she will call and tell the person to go tell me, I'm calling him tomorrow, so wait for me. So I will prepare my time and go there and wait for Mama's call. God help me that day the line goes through. If the line doesn't go through, I'm sitting right there. I'm binding and losing until the line comes through. I will wait for hours. Why? Because I desire to hear her voice. I slept on the couch of my friend's house, waiting for Mama's call. She had promised she was going to call me at a certain time. I waited there because she had network problem because it rained, and it took almost about 7 hours, the call didn't come through. I stayed there. The man went to work and came back in the evening. From morning, I was still there waiting. I will never forget that barrister. And he came back. He said, "You are still here?" I said, "Yes, sir." He made a statement to me. He said, "If this is how everybody will wait for God, we will make it to heaven." Desire. He said, "If this is how everybody will desire to wait from morning, you were here 10 in the morning. Your wife did not call. I came back at almost 8. You are still here waiting for that one phone call." Mama was trying. I prayed. I got tired. I started sleeping on the couch. I said, "Every demon that is stopping this woman from calling me today, I desire to hear her voice." We spend time building everything that will make us happy, physically, naturally. There's nothing wrong with that. But when it comes to the things of the spirit, do we desire the same thing? How much do you desire to pray? How much do we desire to honor God with our tithes and offerings? How much do we desire to serve in the house? Talking about desire. How much do we desire to talk to others about God's mercies and goodness? How much do we desire? Because desire creates pursuit. And somebody might say to me, "Pastor, but I don't know how to pray." But you know how to talk. Hello. You don't have to pray like me. You don't have to pray like Pastor Krisha. No. Just like the way you talk to your earthly father, that is prayer. You don't have to shout like I shout. You don't have to scream like you don't. You talk to him when you desire him. Because he said, "When you pray, I hear you. In your secret place, I hear you. When you desire me, you will talk to me." For those of you who have a good relationship with your parents and family, if you don't hear from your mom or hear from your dad, you feel bad, right? You want to talk to them. That's the same thing God wants from you and I. He wants to hear you talk to him. If you desire him, he wants you to communicate. At least if you don't want to say anything, "Lord, thank you for today. Because I know that without you, I wouldn't be here. Thank you for today. You guided me. I mean, look at what is happening around us. You know, if you remember, you know, I spoke about it here. And I said, please let's pray. Because the Lord was revealing to me that there was going to be a lot of shootings and accidents. Did I say that? And we need to secure our young ones. Not too long, all these shootings are going everywhere. And so many accidents are just within a short period of time. And that was the moment in time. My pastor here, you know, her grandbaby's mother, you know, got into an accident too. Became a victim of that. Look at El Paso. Look at Ohio. I heard about Kansas too. So we have every reason to, because you can get up from here now. Because the people that left their homes to go shopping didn't have no idea. Didn't know anything like that was ever going to happen. They went with the mind that I'm going to go back home to my family, to my children, and some crazy man somewhere got up with whatever idea and did what he did. That's why it's always good that when you go and come back, "Lord, thank you." If you cannot say anything else, "Lord, I just thank you for my day." Even for the food that you have to eat, I have to thank him for it. That you have food to eat when you desire it. These are the things of the spirit, not of the flesh. When you desire to honor God with your tithes and offering, there are some people, that God will bless them. Say, God, bless me, bless me. If you bless me, I will. Remember, there was a desire in the spirit of Hannah. She desired to have a son, to have a son. She desired, she said, Lord, I need, that's all. I would die on this thing. She cried, she said, I need a son. She did in vitro, it didn't work. She did all that IVF, it didn't click. I'm telling you, because I know a family who came from somewhere, and we know them. They told us they've done everything, spent thousands of dollars. The first one's about 20,000, another one 15,000. It didn't click. It didn't click. But we released a prayer. We said, wait. See, that money, you should have used it and bring it to church. Sow it on the altar. Don't give it to me. Sow it on the altar. Some people don't understand some of these principles. I'm telling you now. 20,000 gone. You already signed. And they'll tell you, whether it happens or it doesn't happen, is no more our business. We're going to do our job. She did it 3 times. Until she finally remembers that, you know what? I can only go back to God. The Bible says, in His time, He makes all things beautiful. The doctor said, there's nothing wrong. We prayed. Boom, before you know it, she took in. Twins. I say, now, that 20,000, 15,000, go and calculate it. Bring it right here. And tell God, thank you. But sometimes when God has even done something for some people, and they are supposed to thank God with an offering, because there is no desire. I don't think the Lord needs this. I don't think God, no, this is too much to give to the church. But when you desire the things of the Spirit, the things of the Spirit begat the things of the Spirit. There is a connection and something you are doing. I'm telling you, there has to always be a contact, a form of contact. But for us in this generation, money means much more to us than goats. Nobody is dragging no goat to church. If you come in here with goat, well, we'll curry it. She said, we'll curry it, you know. We'll make pepper soup with it. Amen. But money, because money means something to us. When you desire the things of God, money will mean nothing to you. Because He's the one that giveth you strength to make wealth. He's the one that gives. Without the strength of God, you won't make this money. Remember Steve Jobs. Remember the late Steve Jobs. You need to understand that this money has a spirit. When you don't know how to connect your money to the right source, I spoke the other day to you and I said, money, the real meaning of money is called currency. Currency. And currency comes from the word current, which means shock or current. So anything that has a current has a word power. This light has what? Power. Because it has a current. Now the word currency comes from the word, you know, a current. So anything that comes into your hand has got the power to exchange something. So when money comes into your hand, that means God has given you the power to exchange with something. When you desire God's greatness, you must know how to release tithes and offerings and seed. I love to sow seeds. I love to sow seed. Givers never lack. Givers never lack for the things of God. I'm glad today that some of you are catching the revelation, the kitchen and the things we post, and some people, you know, are helping to buy things in the kitchen and all of that. And those of you who are here are keen into it. There is always a reward for everything you do. As far as the kingdom of God is concerned, let's read the book of Galatians chapter 5 verse 16. Give me the NIV. Galatians chapter 5 verse 16. All right. Are you getting something? All right. The Bible says, so I say, live by what? the Spirit, and you will not gratify. What that word gratify means, satisfy the desires of the sinful nature. Hold it right there. Live by what? The Spirit. And you will not gratify the desires of the sinful nature. God wants you to live by the Spirit, not by your flesh. Children of God. I know somebody's going to be asking me, how do you mean live by the Spirit? How do I live by? Do I be speaking in tongues everywhere I go? That's the Spirit. Or should I be carrying my Bible? Or should I wear a big cross? That's not how God wants us to live by the Spirit. But I'm going to explain to you how to live or walk by the Spirit. How do we walk or live by the Spirit? Number one. How do we walk or live by the Spirit? Now, how do we walk or live by the Spirit? Number one, you must set your mind on the things of God. Your mind must be set on the what? Things of God. Because if your mind is set on the things of God, then you will not be so moved by, I just want to have this. I just want to have this. I just want to have this. If I don't have this, do you know some people who just want to have everything? Sometimes they don't even have the time to enjoy it. If you have the time to enjoy it. But when your mind is set on God, you know, I always used to tell my wife, I tell God, Lord, bless me that I won't forget you. Bless me in such a way that I won't sin against you. And also, don't make me poor that I will go sin against you. All right? Keep me balanced. I don't want to be poor, and I don't want to be too rich that I forget, because sometimes you can get overly too rich and you forget God. You forget God. Because you want to gratify and satisfy the desires of your own nature. Romans 8:5. The Bible says, those who live according to the flesh have their minds set on what the flesh. NIV. Is that NIV? Those who live according to the sinful nature have their minds set on what the nature desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. What is your Spirit desiring? What does your Spirit desire? To know Him more. What does your Spirit desire? Say that again. To do right. To know Him more. What does your Spirit desire? Now, the other day, Charmaine talked to me. And as a matter of fact, this message came out by what we talked with her. That was how I got this message. And she asked me a question. She said, we spoke and said something to me that pointed me to this message. It's like, I want to know about this, about that spiritual stuff. I want to learn about this, about that. I want to know more about God. I want to learn. There are some things I'm asking questions about that I'm desiring to know about this and about that. And I spoke to her and I gave her some materials. So, what really, or how does God want us to desire the things of the Spirit? How do we desire the things of the Spirit? Is it just by coming to church? Hello? Is it just by... It'll be hard for you to accommodate the spirit of rebellion when you're set and driven by the Spirit. It'll be hard for you to accommodate the spirit of anger just anyhow. You have people that go poof every second. When you walk by the Spirit, remember Jesus walked by the Spirit. That's to tell you that man is a spirit. And so Satan's spirit led him. That means Satan's spirit can lead you to destruction. When you walk by flesh, because anything that fleshly is the enemy. Huh? Contrary is contrary to the Spirit of God. It will lead you out. And then Jesus looked at this dude and said, you know what? Man shall not live. Why? Because he plugged in, his nature was the Spirit of God on the inside of him. That is to say, when you desire the Spirit of God, you'll be able to combat the spirit of the flesh. When you desire the Spirit of God, I am telling you, you'll be able to combat or fight against that spirit that comes in to whisper all negativity to your mind. We just preached a message on the mind. Go on our Facebook and our YouTube, we have it. And please, those of you who have not subscribed, subscribe to our YouTube. Because sometimes the messages are downloaded, so you can play it and listen to it all over again. So, live by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the flesh, the desires of the flesh. Number two, how do we walk by the Spirit? Number two, you must put to death the deeds of the body by the Spirit. You must put to death, the deeds of the body by the Spirit. Romans 8:13. How to walk by the Spirit of God and the desires of God, the Spirit, you must put to death the deeds of the body by the Spirit. Oh my God. This one here is heavy. Put to death the deeds of the body. What are the deeds of the body? That's my question right now. What are the deeds of the body? What does the body want? Whoo! Food, yes, we have to eat to sin, other things. What are the deeds of the body that you have to put to death? We can't put food to death. Well, some people, yeah, we can't, yeah. Because there are some people that eat overly, excessively out of control. Yeah, drinking, you know, anything that is of excess, alcohol, drugs. The Bible says you must put it to death. You must kill it. That means take it out completely. Jealousy, anger, hurt, judgment. Come on now. Gossip. Satan is the father of it. The Bible says that when he speaks his own native language. Lies. Okay? The Bible says here, for if you live according to the flesh, you will die. Because do you know that? Now, this is in two parts. When he said die, he's not talking about, you're just going to die physically, you know. A spiritual death. Okay? It's not that if you live according to flesh, you're going to. But sometimes that can also lead you to natural death. Because when you drink and overdrink yourself and you didn't kill the flesh, you can get into an accident. And some people have taken overdose of things and it has killed them. They die. I just saw on the news the other day that one of the Kennedys, she overdosed herself. You know? Because the nature of the flesh was not dealt with. It can lead to death, even not just only spiritual, but I believe that, you know, this year is talking directly as far as spiritual. That means your spiritual life is going to be dead. And when your spiritual life is dead, Satan lights up something on the inside. Then he can now kill you physically. Are you getting that? That if by the Spirit you put to death the misdeeds of the body, you will live. I mean, this is scripture. I didn't put that there. If by the Spirit you put to death the misdeed of the body. What are the misdeed? Lust of eyes. Oh my God. This eye. I went to see my doctor yesterday. Was it yesterday, Mama? My vision guy. Because I was trying to make sure that I'm not having any issue with my eye. Because I want to see. I'm very curious. I don't want anything to affect my eye. Okay. You know, we had the situation in my family that my father had, he had glaucoma. And I'm getting to that age where I have to be careful with some things. So I constantly go to check. So one day we're driving my wife in the morning. And I started seeing some things double. I said, Mama, what is that? She said, what is what? I said, I can't see you. My wife was laughing at me. She said, what do you mean you can't see? And you're driving? She said, park. Give me the steering. You can't see and you're driving me. That was so funny. I was seeing things blurry. And it was not literally that I can't see. I was seeing, but it wasn't clear. Mama is not a morning person. She was quiet and meditating and just thinking. The moment I said, I can't see, her face was like. Oh God, I have good time with my wife all the time, man. Oh God. Instead of my wife to say, what happened? She said, you're driving me. You can't see. Park, please. Let me take the wheel from you. And then while I'm driving, we can be talking about it. Oh God. Jesus Christ. So, you know, that's so funny. So then I made an appointment to go see my vision because, you know, it happened twice and I'm like, what is this? So remember I just told you guys that I don't go to sleep till around 3 or late. There are some things that are just not anything. We cause it ourselves. I stay on the computer for hours. My eyes light and everywhere is dark. My eyes on my phone. So that was beginning to strain my eye. So when I wake up, I don't get enough rest in the morning. So, and my eyes is trying to rest and I'm trying to force it to see, you know, I'm trying to really force it. So I start seeing things double. So after the examination, my, you know, the doctor told me, he said, oh, this is, you don't have any problem. They tested everything. I said, it's fine. You got 20/20, you know, you just probably need a reading glass. That's all you need right now. You don't have any problem at all. And behold, I stopped using the phone and my computer late like that at night. You know, and I could see. So when I drove the other day, I drove Mama. She was looking at me like this. Am I going to say something? I said, Mama, don't worry. I got you. I can see clear now. Amen. So what am I saying? I'm saying that whatever you desire that is not spiritually motivated will cause you to destroy you. Number three, how do we walk by the Spirit or live by the Spirit or desire the Spirit is to be led by the Spirit. Number three is to be what? Led by the Spirit. Romans 8:14. For those who are led by what? The Spirit of God are the sons. Whenever you see sons of God, the Bible is referring to both, you know, female and male. Okay? All the sons of God or children of God. Because those who are led by the Spirit, who are desiring, you will be led, which means you will not do things anyhow. You will think before you act. Most of the times, people who act before they think are always led by the flesh. I'm telling you, oftentimes, that's why the Bible tells us that we should be quick to hear but slow to speak. Why? Because he wants you to process things first before you act. Because the enemy will present it quick to you. He's the first one to present it to you. Remember, I said when Jesus fasted 40 days, the first person that showed up was nobody but what? Satan. Who came in and said, Mr. Jesus, here we go again. What's up, boy? You feel good now? You fasted 40 days. I'm going to take you over here now. You see all this? I will give it to you if you can bow down and worship me. That's what he said. And Jesus said, all power in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Because when you live by the Spirit, you command authority. When you live by the Spirit, you are not afraid to confront the enemy. When you live by the Spirit, you desire the things of the Spirit. When you live by the Spirit, you are led by the Spirit of God to do that which God has called you to do. When you truly desire God, the things of the Spirit, we will put away every lust, impurity, greed and evil thoughts, immorality, familiarity, anger, pride, etc., etc., offenses. When you are led by the Spirit of God, when you are led, when you are not led by the, you see this eye that we have. I told God, I say, hey, God, deliver our eyes. And just like the story I was telling you, he said, this eye, I want to see, but I don't want to see, use it to commit sin. But oftentimes, do you know, our eyes have put us in so many trouble. And the Bible is against it. God is against it. Colossians chapter 3, verse 5. Colossians chapter 3, verse 5. Because when you're not led by the Spirit of God, the eye will lead you into things. Do you see? Can't you see? That is exactly what Satan was trying to present to Jesus. He says, put to death, therefore. Put to death, therefore. You can see that comma. Put to death, kill it right away. Now, whatsoever belongs to your earthly nature. What are the earthly natures? Okay. Earthly nature, sexual immorality. What do you understand by sexual immorality? Oh my God. Sexual immorality. I believe you all understand that. We don't have impurity. Lust. What is lust? Lust. Lust is when you look at somebody and then your mind programs a certain way or evil way. You know? We went to Las Vegas with my wife. God will have to deliver that state. I had so much fun, you know, we had a good time. But for the first time we went there, after we finished, I said, Mama, if one is not strong spiritually, don't come to Las Vegas. Don't go to Las Vegas. Right there on the street, they are inviting you free of charge with a card, giving it to you right there. Where can we meet? Right there. And then I'm walking with my wife. This is my wife. I'm walking with her. Then one guy brought one chocolate candy. Hey, beautiful. I said, eh? Be what? Can't you see she's walking with somebody? I even had my cross. You bypassed the cross. And you're, hey, baby. Telling my wife she looked beautiful. I said, don't tell her. I tell her many times. She don't need nobody to tell. Mama was like, Daddy, don't worry about this thing. I said, Mama, I will fight. I'm African. I will fight. Ah! He didn't tell me, how you doing, sir? It's you. He's saying, hey, baby, too. No. There's lust. There's so much lust. We saw all kind of dressing of people that will make a man go, wow. And then the next thing, the enemy says, okay, there you go now. This is some good thing for you. As the lust is that you can look at somebody so nicely, but the moment the lust spirit comes in, then that's where the sin comes in. And that's one of the biggest fight that every man is fighting today. That is one of the biggest fight that pastors, leaders, church members, that is one of the biggest fight we are fighting, we are dealing with today. A man can be so anointed everywhere, everything, but the lust of the spirit. The lust of the spirit. David had the issue with the lust of the spirit. It's the biggest fight. And God said, I'm against it. Put to death that thing. The Bible says, flee from all appearances. Flee from it. If you know that it's going to cause you to run away from it. If you know that you have issues with lust, why are you going to strip club? What you got to do with strip club? He said, I'm going over there to preach, you know, because God has called me. Charmaine, you hear what I'm saying? You know, I'm a man of God, so me and Minister Drew, we're going to that club. We want to cast out every demons in that place. You hear, Mama? She's coming with us. Mama said, I'm coming with you. Pastor LaCrisha will join you. The worst of it is Mama here will join you. She'll wear her boots. There is a time and a place for everything. There's a time and a place for everything. Okay, let's round up. Okay, I got the last ones, last portion now. All right. A lustful desire leads to sin, especially what the eye sees. Okay, let's read the book of Job, Job 31, verse 1. Job 31, verse 1. How do you deal with this eye? How do we deal with this eye? The lust of the eye. How do we deal with it? Anybody? Anybody? How do we deal with it? Look at what the Bible says. There are some things in the Bible that when you read it, you're like, is this in the Bible? Job said, I made what? A covenant. You have to make what? A covenant. You know what a covenant is? Covenant is, you know, when people cut themselves and put the blood together and deep covenant with God that this eye here, no matter what you see, you can get this body. That's a covenant. That's what Job did. He said, I made a covenant with my eyes not to look lustfully at a girl. Some others that transition say at a lady or a woman or a young woman. I made a covenant. This thing here, eyes has landed. I told God, I said, if you want to judge everybody right now, just start from our eye. Start from our eye, because our eyes. That's why it's hard for you to see a blind man sin anyhow. You know, he may sin in other little things here and there, but the blind, because he don't see nothing. We're driven by what we see. Oh, I want this. You start to devise how you're going to do it. How you're going to get it. The eye has landed and gotten a lot of people into a kind of ugly situation. Man has a desire to break the law. We have the desire to break the law. Why? Because when we walk according to flesh, the flesh wants you to do some things that the spirit don't want you to do. They say it's 30 miles per hour. This is too, they need to increase this. I'm doing 50. Doing 50. Bah, woo. But sometimes, not like you really want to do it. And God delivers some of you here. Because I've reading with some of you people before. Pastor LaCrisha. You know, Big Sis. Even when Big Sis, I entered her car one day, she said to me, Pastor, am I driving? She said, today I'm not driving fast. I said, eh? Like this? I said, don't worry, you're doing good. She said, no, you know, when I carry a man of God, I don't speed a lot. I know sometimes I used to speed a little bit. Mama Sylvia, I'm speaking in tongues 24 hours. When she gets on that wheel, she steps, her car is the race car. Poo, mama, slow down. Slow down. And God has been so merciful. Because we have a nature, a human nature, to break from the desire or the nature of God. We have that human nature to always falter. God says, marry one wife. But our desire want to marry 20 wives. Deal with two wives or two women at the same time. I'm trying to understand how some men are able to maintain that. Because dealing with one. Minister Drew, Elder Sam, y'all with me? Y'all with me? Please help me out, because you know it's just me right here. I'm surrounded by all these beautiful women and strong women too. Dealing with one, you need the Holy Ghost times two. Then people will say, I want to have four wives, three women. I have one in Chicago. I have one here. I have one. Yeah, I have desire. How can you maintain that? The flesh wants it. So Paul, yeah, Paul said, the things that I love to do, I find myself not doing. But the things that I hate are the things that I find myself doing. That means there is a desire that has taken over me. I don't want to do it. I don't feel like, but something keep pushing me like, you know, just do it. It's okay. Just do it. But the Spirit of God say, you are breaking the law. And anybody that breaks the law, you get penalized. You get penalized. Amen. If you want to do something, you will find a way, like I already said. But if you don't want to do it, you'll find an excuse. Because when you characterize people by their actions, you will not be fooled by their words. When you characterize people by their actions, you will not be fooled by their words. It is important that when you desire the things of the Spirit, because your actions will tell what you desire more and not your words. Actions will tell. You can come in here and tell me, oh, Pastor, I love you, but really your actions is telling me otherwise. It is easy for people to fool you by their words, but their actions, you can't pretend. Actions cannot pretend. It will always show off. Action speaks louder than words. I've experienced that too many times. Pastor, I love you. I love you. But their action is saying, I don't like you. Those who desire to pray don't wait until during a problem. Desire. You don't wait until during a problem. That's why I was canceling some few people. I said, wait, oh, I have a problem. I need prayer. Like the woman that called today. Thank God Pastor Lucretia was here. I need this. It's only when you have a problem that you now remember how to pray. No. That's not how it works with God. That's not how it works with God at all. The Bible said that effectual fervent prayer of the righteous availeth much. He said, pray without ceasing. That means in the morning I desire to pray. In the afternoon I desire to pray. Late at night I desire to pray. No one how I do my thing, I'm driving, I'm praying. I'm praying and I'm thanking him. Not only when I have a problem, but when God does something good. Not only when God does something good, just telling him good, how good he is. Not only that, but desiring that, God, you've been a father to me. Even when I didn't have a father, you've been a mother to me. When I didn't have a mother, you've been a friend to me. When I didn't have any friend, you've been my superstar. When I didn't know anywhere to turn to, you've been my help in times of need. You've been my provider. When I didn't know where to turn to, you've been my protector. I will thank you with everything on the inside of me. My desire is to know God. My desire is to know God. And that kills the spirit of the flesh. When you desire God, God begins to pour out a new spirit. When you desire God, God begins to change something on the inside. When you desire God, God begins to play his role in your life. When you desire God, God begins to fulfill his promises concerning you. When you desire him, he keeps his word when you desire him.